Mark 12, verse 13 to 17. Then they sent some of the Pharisees and Herodians to Jesus to trap him in his words. When they came, they said to him, "Teacher, we know you are truthful and don't care what anyone thinks, nor do you show partiality, but teach the way of God truthfully. Is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not? Should we pay or shouldn't we?" But knowing their hypocrisy, he said to them, "Why are you testing me? Bring me a denarius to look at." They brought a coin. "Whose image and inscription is this?" he asked them. "Caesar's," they replied. Jesus told them, "Give to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's." And they were utterly amazed at him. This is the word of the Lord.
Fam, I want to remind you that this is a two-part series. So today is part two. Lesego did a wonderful job last week to set us up in terms of elections. Now we're going to talk about it. So if you haven't listened to last week's sermon, please do catch up on it. It's important, I think, to see it as a whole, both weeks. The question on the table today, how do I know who to vote for? How do I know who to vote for? This is where you start. Check this out. Right, yeah? On your knees. Prostrate before God. In faith. Saying, "Holy Spirit, please help me. I have a really important decision to make. I know that government was ordained by you. I know that the church was called to be your body. We're called to be salt and light. You've placed me here as someone eligible to vote in this country. You've called me to you. I'm a Christian. I'm your child. I want to make this decision according to your will. Will you please guide my thoughts? Will you help me to discern? As I do introspection, as I read, as I study, as I listen, and as I talk. In Jesus' name, amen." That's how you start. And I'm telling you, if you don't start here making this really important decision, you will miss out on an opportunity to really discern God's voice and to do something that you feel is aligned with God's will for you. That's how you start. If you're not a believer and you're listening to me today because you like the topic, well, then you only have your own wisdom and knowledge to bank on. All the best. And I mean it. Not sarcastic, like you just don't have anyone else, right? You only have your own thoughts. You should keep listening, though, if you're not a believer, because I think the rest of the sermon will be greatly beneficial to you. After you've done this, do you know what you do next? You do some introspection. And you take the speck out of your own eye before you start pointing at logs in the eyes of others. Jesus Christ said, Matthew 7, verse 4 to 6, "How can you say to your brother, 'Let me take the splinter out of your eye, and look, there's a beam of wood in your own eye.'" Sorry, I messed that one up. Take the beam out of your own eye before you start looking for specks in the eye of the other. My bad. Jesus says, "Hypocrite. First take the beam out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to take the splinter out of your brother's eye." Fam, when we talk about civil servants and government, we want them to have integrity. We want them to serve. We want them to sacrifice. We want them to be honest. We don't want them to be greedy. We don't want them to be hungry for power. Can I ask you, how are those things in your life? Is your yes? Are you honest? Are you never greedy? Do you never struggle for power? Are you a person of integrity or are you not? Because I'm telling you now, you will judge every single face you see on a lamppost with a massive beam in your own eye, picking at their splinters. That's what you do next. So first, dependence on the Spirit. And secondly, you do some real introspection so that you can see the picture clearly of who you're voting for and who's putting themselves out as candidates. Human beings created in God's image, as sinful and broken as you are. And then you come to terms with a few preliminaries. Before you start, let me remind you of a few things. One, we have a Savior. His name is Jesus Christ. There's no Savior in politics, fam. There's no Savior in government. There's no Savior taking up a presidential chair. There is not. We have one. His name's Jesus. And you know what? He wasn't only a historical figure. He's alive today. Exalted at the right hand of the Father. The Lord of armies. The Lord of hosts. The Almighty One. He's in control. And He's watching over every single government on earth. We'll get there now. No one's going to save us. He already did. Secondly, you're voting for a human being. I just said that. Not a superhero. A human being like you. That has families. That has goals. That were created in God's image. And that are sinful and selfish. And that make mistakes. And that are not perfect. You're voting for someone who God loves so much that He sent His Son to die for them. That's who you're voting for. Also, you are voting for someone. You're not voting against someone. The problem in the politics in South Africa is we feel that no one is worth voting for, so we'll just vote for someone who's against someone else. That is a wasteful vote, I'm telling you. If you're going to the polls, hating on everyone, but just voting for someone who's against someone else, you're wasting your vote. You're voting for someone, showing support, and then asking for accountability. We'll get there now. Also, you're not pledging allegiance for the rest of your earthly life to this political party. My word, you are voting for this party for this next round of governance. 5 years. Fam, we are Jesus till we die, people. That's all we are. You cannot be political party A till we die. You can't do it. We have one identity. We stand for the kingdom of God until we die. So cast your vote, and if your party fails, you can change. That's the beauty of democracy. My word. According to our tradition and our cultures and our language, I feel like we have parents in this country that are okay with you switching faiths, just don't switch political party. It can't work like that. If you're a Christian, that's where your first allegiance is. You're voting for someone for the next cycle of governance, fam. Lift the heavy burden off yourself. It's the joy of being in a democracy. So you've prayed, you've done introspection, you've come to terms with these preliminaries. What do you do then? You read, and you study, and you listen. You read actual publications from trusted sources. You read actual facts and actual analysis. And you listen to people you trust and people you love. And then people who love you back and trust you as well. Fam, social media is the worst place to get facts. The worst. You don't even know that person on the TikToks. But the video came to you via WhatsApp. You watched it. Now you're really afraid because the whole place is going to burn. You forwarded to all your contacts and you didn't check any facts. Who is that guy anyway? Or lady? They don't care about you. They care about their own following. That's why they make stupid videos that go viral. Read actual stuff. You can check your facts. Stop forwarding stuff on WhatsApp. Stop doing it. It's not helping. Know what a government is and where it came from. Know what a democracy is and why we have political parties. Know what the government and political parties are supposed to do. Know who the political parties are, what they stand for, what they promise to do if they would govern in whichever way. Know what to look for when making your decision. Do you guys know why all of this matters? Well, the teaching text that Giovanni just read gives us the reason for this. So let's start at the teaching text, and then we'll tackle all of these questions one by one. You guys ready? Let's do it. Let me pray. Lord Jesus, your word is alive. It cuts deep. We always start there. We want to hear you loud and clear. We want to apply what you said to us. We want to be faithful and obedient as your people as we talk about our next round of elections in this country. Speak to us, Lord Jesus. Illuminate our minds and hearts. We pray that in your name. Amen. Look at the teaching text, Mark 12, 13 to 17. I've got some highlights up for you there. Just follow the highlights with me so that we can just get into the flow of the text. They. Okay, so there's a they. Pharisees and Herodians are mentioned. The word trap is mentioned. Hear the dom-dom-dom-dom suspense music. Something's going to go down. There's a statement. Then there's a question. Then the question gets repeated. Then there's the word hypocrisy. There's a coin. There's an image on the coin. Caesar and God is juxtaposed to one another, and the people leave utterly amazed. Whew. Five verses. Crazy how much is in there. This is the last week of Jesus' life. It's after his triumphal entry into Jerusalem. He's entered the city. He's cleansed the temple. He overturned some tables, saying that people made God's house, which is supposed to be a house of prayer for all nations, into a den of robbers. Major festival, lots of pilgrims in Jerusalem, lots of people passionate and desperate, listen, that Jesus is a political figure who will remove the Romans from power. Lots of people in Jerusalem feeling life sucks under this government. This government is killing us. Please save us. Lots of people feeling that. Save us from this government, mean deal with them, and then reestablish a theocracy, let God reign over all of us, and bring your kingdom down to earth, which sounds a lot better than the kingdoms we have here. Lots of people around Jesus wanting that, feeling really passionate about it. Then you've got the Pharisees, who are both a religious group and a political group. You've got the Herodians, who are a political group, who actually hate each other, but they hate someone else so much that they are keen to form a coalition. Does that sound familiar? I hate you. Oh, I hate you back. Let's form a coalition because we hate them. It's politics, fam. It's nothing new. Nothing new. And I'm not being cynical. It's nothing new. They were political enemies, but they are actually uniting together because they feel like Jesus is threatening their vibe. So I have a question for him. This question is a trap. That word trap means being captured so that you can't escape. And here's the question. Should we pay the imperial tax? Now, the Romans loved tax because tax would bring in money, so it would strengthen their kingdom, and it would keep people oppressed because they would tax people so hard that no one could progress or prosper. Okay, so the Roman government at that time had tax for imports, tax on transportation, tax on land, tax on crops, tax on your catches of fish, etc. So lots of tax. The tax that's on the table here now was called poll tax. That is a tax that Jewish people had to pay, not on their land and not on their goods. They were being taxed for being Jewish. That's the tax that's on the table here. So because I hate you so much, and I think so little of you, you will pay me a yearly subscription just because you are you. Hectic. That's the tax that was on the table here. Poll tax. It was a 1 denarius. That's what that word means. Which is a day's wage for the common laborer that you had to pay per year. Why did the people hate this tax? They hated this tax because the implication was that I had to pay you because you own me. Right? Caesar's face is on the coin. And now I pay you just to have the right to exist. Because I'm from the wrong group. And I'm from the wrong race. So there you go. Take my money. Just so that I can keep on breathing in this world. Because if I don't pay you your money, you kill me. So you get to decide whether I live or not. Hardcore. Hardcore. But these Jewish people believe that they belong to God. So just imagine that, the tension. Hey, I'm one of God's people, but no one's treating me like that. God was the one who brought me to this country to come and live here, but now I can't live here because of all the heavy taxes that you're imposing on me. That was the tension that those people sat with. They'd been made subjects to another God, and part of the Ten Commandments is, you shall not serve another God. And then the Pharisees and the Herodians come to Jesus with this trap, and they ask him an unbelievably charged question. Why? Because Jesus will either lose his popularity with the people, or he'll die. That's the choice. Think about it. If Jesus says, no, stuff them. Don't pay the tax. People will go, yes, man. The seeds for revolt is busy coming to fruition. Let's take these people. If Jesus says yes, all of these really passionate people go, oh, well, it seems like he's just in cahoots with them. No saving happening here, fam. Let's back up. Let's go. But if Jesus says no, then they can kill him. How crazy is that? Jesus, God in the flesh, had to pay this tax with a coin with someone else's image on it so that I can keep my image. And that's the image of God in me. Hey? That's where this question comes from. Now look what Jesus says in verse 17. Give to Caesar the things that are Caesar's. Which is what? The money that has his face on. This coin has got an image of someone on it. It's his. Give it to him. Whose image is in you? So whose are you? And that's exactly what Jesus says. Jesus says, and to God the things that are God's. And look how he leaves them. Massive mic drop moment. Utterly amazed. No one saw that one coming. Everyone expected a this or a that. Because that's always how politics works. It's always polarized. Boom! It's always either or. It's never both things together. And Jesus said, give to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's. If I can translate that into South African English, it is, do what is expected of you and remember who you belong to. That's what Jesus says. Do what is expected of you and remember who you belong to. Fam, do you know that we can belong to God as his children, as image bearers of him, and we can be formed into the image of Christ by the presence of the Holy Spirit in our lives, all because Jesus made a way for us. Do you guys know that? Like, Jesus died on the cross to pay for our sins, to pay a payment that satisfied God's wrath, and then he rose from the dead to defeat sin, death, and Satan, and to open up a whole new way of life. We call that eternal life. And then he invited us into that story saying, there's nothing causing a division between us and God anymore. You can be back into the Father's house. Come, 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 come. Repent and believe, repent and believe, repent and believe. That's what he said. So if we say today that Jesus is telling us, do what is expected of you and remember who you belong to, we need to remember why we can belong to him and why we are who we are. But that's the truth. This is who I am. I'm God's child and I'm created in his image. This is who we are. His body, his family, his hands and feet, salt and light in the world. That's not changing. This is who he is, a loving, all-knowing, all-present, sovereign, beautiful God and Father Almighty, who reigns over all things. And this is what's happening at the moment. You can tell me that South Africa is burning, I'll answer you with the kingdom is coming. Because that's the reality, fam. And you need to decide which one you're looking at. Because if you only read the newspaper, you'll see the place is burning. But if you read the Bible, you'll see, wait. God is busy establishing his kingdom on earth through the reign of Jesus Christ, through his church, being witnesses of the good news, adding more and more people to this family, submitting under his lordship. That's what's happening. And that's the truth. I don't care what today's newspaper says. And it's happening because Jesus decided to do it. Now, there are some huge differences between the political world of Jesus' time and our time. Let me just name three. One, Jesus wasn't living in a democracy. Okay? So we'll get to what is a democracy now. Two, in the time of Jesus, they believed that the Caesar, or the one who, like the one who reigned sovereignly, the sovereign, had some sort of connection to the gods. So we say in English, he has a deity, or he is a deity. It's like, is he half human, half God? Is he fully God? We don't know. But the guy up top is a really, really special guy. The power guy. The guy who either came from the gods or who came down from the gods for just a little bit. I mean, Caesar would also be called son of God, you know. So the guy up top had some sort of deistic identity. We don't believe that, right? Our current president is a human being like us from Venda. Okay. Thirdly, in that time you had a religious government. So the government of the day had a faith, right? That faith was called Roman paganism, and they worshipped a pantheon of gods, many gods, all playing their role in the universe and how they ruled. And the whole kingdom and everyone in their power was supposed to believe that. So if you don't believe that, obviously you are at odds with the ruling party. That's not true in South Africa. South Africa has a secular government. I'll tell you what that means a little bit later. People often say we're a Christian country. We might be a Christian country because people say they're Christians. We are not a Christian government. It's really important. We are not a religious government. We are a secular government. I'll get to that now. What's still the same? Well, what's still the same is in the time of Jesus, they were humans. We are also still humans. In the time of Jesus, they needed order to flourish and prosper. We still need that today. In the time of Jesus, people lived in sin. People struggled with power and people were corrupt. And sin and power and corruption kept flourishing and prosperity from happening. That still happens today. In the time of Jesus, these very Jewish people who asked him this question were deeply religious people in a broken system. I don't know about you, but if you call Fellowship City home, we are deeply religious people in a broken system. Still the same. It hasn't changed. Do what is expected of you and remember who you belong to. I would like to put it to you this morning that you are expected to vote if you are eligible to vote. So do it. If you're going to abstain from voting, you're going to keep a democracy from working. Because a democracy works if everyone votes. So vote. It is expected of you. Do it. You do it, though, as a child of God. How great's that? You do it as salt and light. You do it with your head held high because your core identity isn't the color of the political party you're wearing. We're going to queue on the voting day ready to make our crosses on the ballots as children of God. How freeing is that? I don't have to go stand at my voting station and feel all of this tension between all of these parties because I don't belong to them. I'll pledge support for one of them, but I don't belong to them. I belong to someone else. I can actually be friendly at a voting station. I can actually be really nice to the people handing me the ballots. I can be really nice to the people at the coffee station outside and the car guard looking after my car where I park. True story. What is a government and where did it come from? Let me give you a short definition. A government is the political system by which a country or community is administered and regulated. Administration. Regulation through a system That's called a government. Are you guys with me? Most of the key words that we use to describe a government, we say words like monarchy, oligarchy, democracy. Most of those words come from Greek or Roman origin. We are a democracy. Will you guys read with me what a democracy is? Okay. Now, stay with me. Don't lose me now. We still have some way to go. We're going to do a lot of reading. But fam, it's right there and it's facts. And you need to know this. So if you start feeling like this is a university lecture, just bear with me. Okay, here we go. There's nothing wrong with a university lecture, I'm just saying. This was taken from our own government's website. I didn't cook this up. And I didn't get this from an English university textbook. It's from our own website. Okay, here we go. The word democracy comes from the Greek word demokratia, which means government by the people. Read with me. Point one. Democracy is a balance between might and right. The state takes all the power, it has all the might, but its power must be limited so that it does not abuse this power to make sure it does right. The Constitution, we'll get to what the Constitution is, guarantees the independence of the courts and establishes 6 independent institutions to protect citizens. The Public Protector, the Human Rights Commission, the Commission for the Promotion and Protection of the Rights of the Cultural, Religious and Linguistic Minorities, the Commission for Gender Equality, the Auditor General, and the IEC, the Independent Electoral Commission. Fam, if you read about these institutions in the news, you should actually care about it. Because these institutions are supposed to protect us as citizens of this country. Don't just fly past it and read the sports news. There's actually some important stuff here. 2. Democracy is about balancing rights and responsibilities. Citizens can expect the government to do things for them like provide protection, health services, education, and housing. Citizens also have responsibilities like obeying the law and paying tax to the state. Hey, we're in a contract here. They do something and we do something. And if we do something and they don't do something, then we should tell them, hey, I'm doing my part, you're not doing yours. We're in a partnership here. 3. Democracy is about balancing the rights of the majority with protection for minorities. If you blow the horn at a minority group saying something in the public space, then you shouldn't live in this country, because this country says that we have to protect minorities. Minorities aren't people who only make noise. Minorities are minorities, and our constitution says they have a place here. 4. Democracy is about achieving a greater balance in society so that there is greater equality for all over a period of time. That's a democracy. Why do we have political parties? Read this with me. Because South Africa is a representative democracy. This means citizens do not govern the country themselves, they elect or vote for other people to represent them in government. That is who you're voting for, someone to represent you. The Constitution, I said we'll get to a definition of the Constitution, says that there are 3 spheres of government, national, provincial, and local, and the citizens choose their representatives in elections for national government, which is parliament, provincial government, which is the 9 provincial legislators, and local government, which is municipalities and our district councils. Elected representatives are said to hold seats in these bodies. Are you guys with me? Let's get practical. Where do I start? Where do you start? Because I said that we should read and study and listen. I want to show you a few resources that I feel has been really helpful. Okay? First one. We do have something like trusted news sites. News24 has won the most trusted news site in South Africa for so many years I stopped counting. So they are actually what I believe a trustworthy news source. Look at this. On its main menu, you've got a button. Elections 2024. My word. And what do they have? Well, there's an elections hub. There's a manifesto meter. There's an elections map. And there's an on-the-road elections tour. That can keep you busy the whole day in terms of the amount of resources there is. News24.com. Enter. Start reading. Check this. There's a manifestometer. If I can have the next slide, please, Rudolph. Look at this really cool tool. The manifestometer allows you to compare manifesto promises of political parties on key metrics. I'll show you that key metrics now. Then they say scroll down for all the parties or filter by metrics of your choice. And there we go. They are all the big players in the South African political sphere at the moment. So you can either scroll down and read everything they said in their manifesto, nicely summarized for you in bullet points. Or you can say, I'm curious to know what the different parties say about different metrics. Then you click on this button, if I can have the next slide, please, Rudolph. And then all of a sudden, all of those things come up, and you go, education. I've got kids in school. I want to see what these political parties say about education. Boom, you hit the education button, and it'll take all of these political parties, and it'll extract from their manifestos what they said about education. Come on now. It's a really easy resource, and it's right there in front of you. Not the TikToks. Use this. It's written by actual, reputable journalists who know their story, who can defend their case. If I can have the next slide, please, Rudolph. They've got articles like this. How great. The ballot breakdown, XXX. This is what to do on voting day, 1X for each of the three ballots. Did you know that? What ballots are we talking about? I'm so glad you asked. Next slide, please, Rudolph. They even give you a little breakdown. There you go. There's a blue for the national ballot. There's an orange for the regional ballot. And there's a pink for the provincial ballot. Here's exactly who you will vote for on each ballot. I know that some of you can't read anymore. It's a real shame. So then they actually make pictures for you to look at. So if we can have the next one, please. There you go. There's a little infographic for you. Because you can't read anymore. Blue, orange, and pink. And it gives you a little breakdown of what the ballot will look like, and it'll tell you who you're voting for on that ballot. You don't have to guess. And please don't leave this to the morning of the 29th of May for when you queue. And then you go, oh, second sip of coffee, I'm awake now. Who do we vote for? Who are you going to vote for? Who are you voting for? And I also want to say that if you have a spouse, then don't just ask, who are we voting for? Have some really good conversations about this. And in exactly the same way that you can support two different sports teams in your house, you can actually vote for two different parties too. Just saying. Okay, can I have the next slide, please, Rudolph? We also have access to resources like this. South Africa's Easy Election Guide, who to vote for in 2024. It was written by what I believe is a trustworthy foundation. That's 144 pages. So if you're a real nerd, then I'll send this to you. If you're not a real nerd, go back to News 24. Okay. 144 pages. Great breakdown of every political party. If I can have the next slide, please, Rudolph. Look at something like this. It gives you an introduction of where the study comes from. And then it tells you, here are the key electoral issues in the country. And then it gives you every party. Their history, the electoral record, the positions they have, and then what they say in their manifesto about each of these topics. How easy is that? To actually go and read what a party says about what they stand for. Rudolph, I can't remember how many slides we have. Can I see the next one, please? Ah, here we go. Here's another resource for you. Let me get back on stage. This Rooted Fellowship is one of our sending churches, right? So we can call them a partner church. They did a panel discussion with a public policy researcher. It's an hour and 28 minutes long. The sermon is called Church and Empire, Part 2. Fam, it's worth listening to. I know an hour and a half is a long listen, but woo! Kagiso is on it. And he's got way more knowledge than I do about these things. So download the podcast and listen to it. Also available on all of your favorite podcasting platforms. Now, the only reason why I know that is Rooted Fellowship uses the same podcast platform as we do. Okay, can I have the next one, please, Rudolph? Okay. Now, a few important remarks. You hear that political parties often refer to the Constitution. Yes, Ben?
Just a quick question on
Yep.
versus political
Yeah.
Because the two is not the same.
Yeah.
So just reading their manifest will give us what they believe in, doesn't necessarily tell us how they behave.
Yeah. Yes,
sir. Can I get there at the end? Because I think those are some of the filters that we need to look through. Okay, so thank you. You picked that one up quick. You'll often hear the political parties say a lot about the Constitution. Do you know what the Constitution is? Let's read what the Constitution is. South Africa is a constitutional democracy. The Constitution is the highest law. No person can go against it, not even the president. Parliament cannot pass any laws that goes against it. The courts and the government must also make sure that what they do is constitutional. The Constitution guarantees democracy through giving every person over 18 the right to vote and ensuring one voter's role for all adult citizens, regular elections, and a multi-party system of government. These important parts of the Constitution can only be changed if 75% of the members of the National Assembly and 6 of the 9 provinces agree. All aspects of how our democracy works are explained in the Constitution. That's why this document is very, very important. And when we get to the political parties in a few minutes' time, you'll see why. Okay. Let's look at what the government is. Here's a definition for you. Next slide. The political party that wins the majority of seats in an election for parliament, more than 50%, has the right to form the government. Okay? So the government is guided by the Constitution, but who's the government? Now it says, it is called the majority or the ruling party. The other parties are called minority parties or opposition parties. The government is not permanent. The citizens give it the right to rule the country for 5 years. Do you guys see that? This is written on our own government's website. The government's not permanent. The government is formed according to who we vote for. Tongue twister. The Constitution explains that the president is elected by parliament after an election. He or she forms the government by appointing the deputy president and the cabinet. The cabinet is made up of the president, the ministers, and the deputy ministers. Each minister leads a government department. For example, the Minister of Finance leads the Department of Finance. Okay. Now, that's the government. I said earlier that South Africa has a secular government. That doesn't mean that there's no place for faith or religion in South Africa. Here's what it means. We have in our constitution a country that says we have religious freedom. You can worship who you want, however you want, as long as it doesn't go against the constitution. That's why we can plant 9 more fellowship cities and beyond, and no one will ever imprison us for being Christians and part of Fellowship City. It's a joy. It's a freedom we have in our country, is the fact that we have religious freedom. A secular government says we are not choosing for any religion over the other. We have a neutral position. That's what a secular government is. A secular government says we are not for religion, and we are also not for irreligion. We are neutral. Do you see that? That's really important. Because that means that we cannot expect this government, according to that constitution, to do everything that Christians want them to do. Because they don't care. Because they are a secular government. They have a different guide document. Obviously, Christians can express their concerns. Obviously, Christians can help create policy. Do you guys know that there are Christians in government as well? Beautiful, spirit-filled, Jesus-loving people working in government. Influencing there, bringing salt, being salt and being light. There are many Christians in government, but we can't expect the government to behave according to the Sermon on the Mount, because this government isn't a Christian government. It's a secular government. Okay, now, we have, you guys saw that list of political parties down on the screenshot from News 24. The bulk of our parties sit in what we call the center. Meaning, we are for the constitution, we are for secular government. So as a party, we operate according to that document in our country. That document will guide us. The bulk of our political parties sit there. Then you also have what we call the right. Now, the right can sometimes be called conservative. And what characterizes the so-called right is they would say, yes, we care about the Constitution, but there's actually another book that's got different values that we care for too. And we are going to fuse these two. So you have Christian parties who sit to the right, who say, yeah, we understand the Constitution, but the Bible is above it. So we want to act in the boundaries of the Constitution, but according to the Bible. And then you have some other parties that have got distinct Christian values, but they wouldn't call themselves a Christian party, but they would also say that we side with the Christians. So you have those parties on the right of the center. Then we also have parties, Beyonce, to the left. Those parties can be called liberal parties, or they can be called revolutionary parties. They are parties who say, look, we understand the Constitution, but we want to change it because it sucks. We want more for this country and from this country. So we are going to fight the very founding document of this country, well, the country's democracy, and we don't care about faith at all. No faith book, no religion is on our table. That's liberal. So we have parties in our country, the bulk of them in the center, saying we don't mind religion, but the Constitution is the thing. We have parties on the right, we know the Constitution is the thing, but the Bible and some other religious documents also sit on that side. And then we have parties who say, we don't care about religion at all, and on the contrary, we think the Constitution is moving too slowly, we want to change this bad boy and change a whole lot of things around. That's what we have. Now, how do I choose who to vote for as a follower of Jesus? Let's go, Rudolf, can we go back to the screenshot of the electoral issues, the one that says education, please? Here's what you need to know. At the moment, in South Africa, these are the big issues. Now, that drop down, please, Rudolf, that said education with a tick on, it's the second slide of these pictures. Here you go. Load shedding, water. Isn't it ironic that I say load shedding and we hear the Jenny running? Hey? Great white noise. Water, economy, jobs, health, corruption, education, crime. These are the big things. So if your political party doesn't say anything about these things, then don't vote for them. Question is, what do they say about this? And how do we filter through it? Okay, so I want to show you a few questions. Rudolf, if we can have the slide that we just returned from, please. I don't even know what slide it is anymore. There you go. How do I choose who to vote for as a follower of Jesus? This is my take. This is Rainer Meyer speaking. I think you should ask, are they ordering society for human flourishing? Fam, this world was created so that humanity could flourish. The garden was called paradise. More than enough for everyone, no one at odds with one another, everyone perfectly obedient and working together to execute God's will. Sin broke it. Government was established by God and ordained by Him to reorder the world, not so that someone can win and someone can lose, but so that the world can return back to its ways of flourishing. Do you guys realize that we talk about the kingdom of God? What is the kingdom of God? The kingdom of God is a system of ruling. Who's ruling? Jesus. And what is He ruling for? So that humanity can return back to flourishing. So, is this political party ordering society for human flourishing? Now, I'm making this criteria really wide. And you need to be wise and prayerful. Remember, we started on our knees. When you read these manifestos and when you work through all this information to see, is this really what this political party is all about? Ordering society for human flourishing. Second question. Are they working for justice? Justice, in the biblical sense, means everyone has everything they need. A political party that doesn't work for justice is not a party worth voting for. Because we as Christians believe in justice. And we as Christians believe that as we see justice being done and justice being executed, we see the kingdom of God. Because the haves share with the have-nots. And the have-nots get uplifted and restored. And they have a place in the community. And minority groups and oppressed people are protected. Are they working for justice? Justice is a massive value of the kingdom. Justice on the one hand and righteousness on the other hand. They go together in the Bible. So everyone has everything they need and everyone is in right relationship with one another and God. Are they working for justice? Are they creating an environment for prosperity? Prosperity doesn't mean that everyone is rich and they can go to French Polynesia whenever they want. That's not prosperity. Prosperity means that the gifts of this world and the gifts of the people in the world are managed and stewarded to make the world a better place. That's what it is. So prosperity means everything from what is in the world and actually in the earth and everyone who is on the earth. Do we care about what God has placed in the people in South Africa? And do we care about what God placed within the borders of South Africa? Do we care about what He gave us and how He wants to use all of this so that we can be a people of prosperity? Your political party, are they creating an environment for prosperity? Or are they not? And then fourth one, are they working for safety? Fam, listen to me. More than half of our country's population are women. Do you guys realize that crime is so high in our country that half of our population never leave their house when it's dark? Think about that. How enslaving is that? That half of our population only ever leave their house when the sun's up. Because when it's dark, I might die. What kind of country is that to live in? That's why it matters what political parties say about crime. I don't know about you. I don't know about many women in our community. They'll say, at evening, I will walk in a street with no street lights. I feel so safe. YOLO. I don't even feel safe in the evening, and I'm a man. I know I'm a small man, but man. That's not right, fam. That's not right. We stand next to a netball field watching our one daughter play, and every second minute we have to just check where our other daughter is. How can we live like that? How can we park our car outside of school not knowing if it's going to be there when we come back? Every single day. Is your party working for safety? Because that's what they're supposed to do. They say on their own website, according to our constitution, that we can expect our government to keep us safe. Okay, so how do I choose who to vote for as a follower of Jesus? Last 4 points, and Ben, I'm going to get back to what you asked now. First question. I'm almost done, guys. I'm almost done. First question. What are the policies that are being supported? So you have to know how this party says, are they going to fix this thing? Because all the parties make great promises, you know. How? What's the policy? Because remember, a government starts up top, and then they pass laws, and then it dribbles down to grassroots. So if you have a solution to a problem, how? What's the policy? And then if you look at the key burning topics, you can make grand promises, but if the policy doesn't support it, it's never going to be done. Okay, so what are the policies that are being supported? Secondly, then back to your question, what's the character of the candidates that are putting this forth? Who says that they are going to do this? If you're a Christian and you vote for someone with a poor track record, bad character, and zero integrity, you cannot expect of them to turn it all around in one election cycle. It's not going to happen. It's the same as me rocking up at the Springboks saying, I will now take over the place-kicking duties. Thank you very much. Ooh, I can make grand promises. I will slot those bad boys over from halfway in the corner, Frans Steyn of old. And Dr. Rassie Erasmus will say, can I maybe see some of your place-kicking? Can I see where you've played? And if I can't show him that I can do it, why on earth would he select me? We have to be wise in looking after the character of the people that we support. Because I said earlier we're voting for someone, not against someone. And I said earlier that with our ex we pledged support for 5 years. Third, what sort of competencies do they have to do the job? We have some doctors in the house. They've got a competency that I don't have. So let's say Marie would faint and lose consciousness. I mean, I can be really passionate about saving her life. Who's going to trust me to do it? I simply can't. I don't have the skills. I've got no idea. But if one of our doctors would come, we would go, we actually think that you can do the job here. Because you know how. If you study your political party that you think that you are going to vote for through the guiding of the Holy Spirit, then ask, do they have the competencies to do this? Can this person do finance if they say they're going to take responsibility for finance? Does this person know anything about education? Does this person know anything about engineering in the power sector? What's their track record? You have to ask that question. And then lastly, and I think this is an important one, have they done the hard work of actually figuring out how they're going to do this? Think about this. We are going to do promise A. Okay, great. How? Have you actually made the calculations? Have you actually figured out how much it would cost if we do A, B, C, and D? Have you actually written a document that says it's going to take us 10 years and 500 billion rand of investment to get there, and this 500 billion rand of investment will come from A, B, C, and D over the course of these last 10 years, and then our goal in 10 years is that. I'll support a political party that's actually done that work. Because you can make grand promises. I'm going to end poverty. Nice. Show me the spreadsheet. How? And from where? If I would say to you today that I can sort out all your financial woes, what are you going to ask me? Reina, show me the bank account, man. Where's the money? Where's the storehouses? And then I go, no, look, I don't have the money yet. But I'll sort you out. Just vote for me. It's irresponsible if you do that. Then it's not government by the people. Have they done the hard work? Do you guys realize that I've preached for 52 minutes on who you should vote for without mentioning a single political party's name and without mentioning a single political leader? I did that intentionally because I don't want you to be biased. I want you to be dependent. And I didn't want to influence you for a political party. I wanted to influence you to get on your knees and to realize how important this is. Have they done the hard work? Last excerpt that I want to show you from our governance website, there's actually a question that says, how can you participate in Parliament? Do you know that you can participate? Here you go. The Constitution says that there must be public participation in what goes on at Parliament. It's great to see you guys, Lesego. We are almost done. Great timing. You have the right to attend the meetings of parliamentary committees, the sittings of the National Assembly, and sittings of the National Council of Provinces. You also have the right to contact any member of parliament or parliamentary committee to tell them what you think about an issue they are discussing, or to tell them about what you think they should be discussing. Parliament has a duty to take the views of the public into account when it passes a law. The word parliament comes from the word meaning to speak. Make sure that you use your right to speak on an issue you feel strongly about. It's an invitation. It's a right we have in a democracy. Let's go back to the steps. Pray. Introspection. Preliminaries. Read, study, and listen. Decide, vote, and engage. I want to show you one last picture, and then we'll be done. This is the IEC's website. It's awesome. Have you ever been on it? Little drop-down menu, voters. Check my voter registration status. Hey, and look at this nice button. Who is my ward councillor? Do you know that you are in a ward? Not a ward, a ward. Do you know what your ward number is? Do you know who your ward councillor is? Because in South Africa, because we have wards, we have ward councillors, which means we have people who are responsible for a certain geographic area to do what the government said they will do. That's our first contact point. They are available. If you type in your ID number, it'll show you, boom, there's your ward councillor, their number, their representative, their admin assistant, how many votes they had, which election it was, what they stand for. It's all right there. You don't have to guess. You don't have to go to Spar and go, hey, guy, do you know what ward number we're in? Like, where do you live? Lenshen? Oh, no, I'm over there. Yeah, is the same ward. So you have a button like this. They'll tell you who your ward councillor is. Can I tell you what I think? I think our first place to engage is with our ward councillors. Contact them. Tell them that you are praying for them. Ask them what they're busy with. And ask them how you can help. We have a ward WhatsApp group. I'm on it. It's great. People ask questions about when are they going to come and pick up the branches on the sidewalk. People talk about streetlights being out. People talk about power outages. These are things that our government is responsible for. We actually have someone we can ask. What would it be like if the people of Fellowship City invited our ward councillor for dinner? Wouldn't that be nice? Come and eat with us. I would love to hear who you are, why you're here, and why you care for these people. This morning at 2:26, the group started ringing because the power's out. And our ward councillor is on it. I want to ask him what it's like to wake up on Mother's Day to 75 messages of disgruntled residents. And then to sacrifice your whole morning, if you possibly would have gone to church and then had lunch with your mom, and now you have to sort out a power outage. How's that for you? Can I thank you for it? Can I bless you with a meal? It's not too much to ask, fam. We should engage. Let's pray. Holy Spirit, we are dependent on you to make this decision. We know the importance of this. We know why this matters. Lord Jesus, we don't feel a weight because of this decision, because we know that we should do what is expected of us and we should remember who we belong to. Help us to approach this election season with that lightness, that surety, and that faith that we are your children, that you've placed us here for something really specific, that you have something for us to do here, and that is to be salt and light, and that your Holy Spirit empowers us to make these decisions. May your name be glorified in the way that we read, we study, and we listen. May your name be glorified in the way we pitch up to vote. May your name be glorified in the way we choose to engage. Because we know, Lord Jesus, that everyone who lives in this ward and in the other wards we live in are created in your image. You care for them. You sent your Son to die for them. And you want all of us to flourish. You're bringing paradise back through your kingdom. And we want to see that. We know that government was ordained by you, and therefore we want to play our part to see your will being done. Guide our thoughts, guide our hearts, guide our mouths, Lord Jesus, we pray. Amen.